Many soil properties impact soil quality, but organic matter deserves special attention. It affects several critical soil functions, can be manipulated by land management practices, and is important in most agricultural settings across the country. Because organic matter enhances water and nutrient holding capacity and improves soil structure, managing for soil carbon can enhance productivity and environmental quality, and can reduce the severity and costs of natural phenomena, such as droughts and floods. In addition, increasing soil organic matter levels can reduce atmospheric carbon dioxide levels that contribute to climate change. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I'll discuss managing organic matter. It should be a goal of all growers to maintain organic matter at the highest practical level. Equally important is the frequent addition of fresh organic matter. It is new organic matter that provides most nourishment for soil microbes and releases nutrients rapidly. Conservation tillage, especially no-till, reduces the influx of oxygen into the soil. Much of crop residue remains on the soil surface to decay slowly. Because the soil is covered with organic litter, erosion is reduced. Simply leaving residues in the soil is an easy way to provide organic matter. With the exception of root crops, such as carrots and nursery stock, plant roots automatically stay in the field after harvest. The above-ground parts of crops, for which only the seed is harvested, are also usually left in the field. The homeowner's version of preserving residues is leaving grass clippings to decay on the lawn, rather than removing them. Some vegetation is planted strictly as a soil management tool, rather than as a crop to be harvested. Green manure may be incorporated into four broad systems of production. First is traditional green manure, planted as a main crop for later plowdown, though killing the crop and planting into it no-till works even better. It is a standard and important practice for nursery growers to renew organic matter between crops of trees and shrubs. Two types of plants can be grown as green manures. Legumes, such as clover or vetch, are useful because, in addition to the organic matter they leave behind, the nitrogen they fix supplies later crops. To get the most bulk out of organic matter at the least cost, or if nitrogen additions are undesirable, grasses such as oats or rye may be used. Sudan grass, a tropical grass that grows to 6 feet, develops the greatest amount of green matter and is particularly popular with nursery growers. Where winter erosion is a problem, a cover crop may be planted in the fall after the main crop is harvested. The green cover protects soil during the fall, winter, and early spring when it is most erosion prone. The cover crop is then killed in the following spring, or even better, simply killed with an herbicide and planted into no-till. A cover crop may also be planted immediately after harvest of a rapidly maturing crop, like oats following peas in the same season. Last, a cover crop may be planted between rows of the main crop. This cover is sometimes called a companion crop or living mulch. Economic factors often cause growers to avoid rotating crops because it means growing less profitable crops a few years. However, crop rotation improves soil humus. Studies show that continuous cropping of row crops such as corn causes the greatest decline in soil organic matter. Grains cause smaller loss, while meadow or hay legumes, for example, alfalfa and clover, actually increase organic matter levels. Thus, a rotation of row crops, small grains, and legume hay is better than continuous cultivation of row crops. The sources of organic matter described so far are all grown in the field. Many growers or gardeners can import other organic materials into their fields, including animal manures, organic waste, sewage sludge, or compost. Compost is organic material that has been allowed to decay above ground. The availability of these materials depends on the kind of operation and the presence of local organic waste producers. Manure is an important source of both organic matter and plant nutrients. For the farming operation that both grow crops and feed animals, manuring recycles nutrients and organic carbon on the farm. Yard and municipal waste and sewage sludge may also be available near cities. These organic materials are usually composted before use. Home gardeners often mulch their gardens by spreading straw, sawdust, wood chips, or other materials several inches deep on the ground. As the organic matter decays during the growing season, it enriches the humus content of the top few inches of soil. Besides adding organic matter, mulches smother weeds, improve soil water content, and reduce erosion, limit water evaporation from soil surface, and moderate soil temperature. Many growers mulch high-value crops such as berries or nursery stock. Mulches almost always make striking improvements in the yields of blueberries, strawberries, raspberries, and tree fruits. As much as possible, soil should be covered with crops. soils will be cooler and more organic matter will be produced. Where possible, double cropping or the production of two crops a year is desirable. Avoid fouling as much as possible. Permanent soil cover of perennial plants, particularly grasses, greatly enhances soil quality and soil carbon. While difficult to incorporate into many farming rotations as currently practiced, there is a place for this. Well-managed pasture is a perennial cover, as are many natural restoration projects. A new system of growing plants and crops called permaculture emphasizes perennial covers. Soil flora need both carbon and nitrogen in their diet to grow and multiply. When fresh organic matter is added to the soil, whether it be crop residues, green manure, or manure, the number of organisms rises because of the new food. These organisms may compete with crop plants for nitrogen, causing a slowing of crop growth. The organic matter of greatest concern contains a lot of carbon compared with nitrogen. This can be measured by the carbon-nitrogen ratio, C to N ratio, of the material. The C to N ratio of well-rotted manure is about 20 to 1, meaning that there are 20 parts of carbon for each part of nitrogen. The table shows the C to N ratio for soil and several common organic materials. Matter with a low C to N ratio is nitrogen rich. Material with a high C to N ratio is nitrogen poor. Young, fresh, green matter usually has a lower C to N ratio than older and dead brown material. As a leaf ages, its cellulose carbon content rises while its protein nitrogen content declines. As a leaf reaches the end of its life, most of the nitrogen is translocated out of the leaf for use in other parts of the plant. So brown plant material tends to have high C to N ratios. The effect of tissue age can be seen by comparing the C to N ratios of young and mature alfalfa, 13 versus 25. When nitrogen-poor materials begin to decay, the rising number of microbes robs soil of nitrogen. Soil microflora average a low C to N ratio of about 8 to 1, lower for bacteria and higher for fungi, so they need to incorporate a lot of nitrogen into their bodies. Microflora feed on both carbon and nitrogen in the material, but with high C to N materials, nitrogen is quickly used up. During the nitrogen depression period, nitrogen is tied up, immobilized, faster than it is released, mineralized. As decay slows, the number of organisms declines and nitrogen is released. Materials with a greater C to N ratio than about 30 to 1 favor immobilization. Those with a ratio of less than 20 to 1 favor mineralization. Fully composting organic residues before incorporating them into the soil eliminates nitrogen tie-up. Composting ideally mixes high carbon residues such as dead leaves or wood chips with high nitrogen residues such as manure or green grass clippings in ways that promote rapid decay. When complete, the C to N ratio falls to about 15 to 1, a safe addition to the soil. Soils containing more than 20% to 30% organic matter are called organic soils and are mostly classified as histosols. These soils are much different than mineral soils. In organic soils, soil traits are set by the organic matter. The five states with the most organic soil are Alaska, Minnesota, Michigan, Florida, and Wisconsin. Organic soils form in marshes, bogs, and swamps. As aquatic vegetation, such as reeds or cattails, dies each season, it sinks to the bottom. Lacking the air needed for rapid aerobic decay and oxidation, material builds up on the floor of the wetland. Eventually, wetlands may be completely filled in by organic deposits reaching depths ranging from 1 foot to as much as 80 feet. You can see a common organic soil profile formed in a black spruce's sphagnum moss bog. Organic soils in which plant remains are only slightly decayed are commonly called peat. If the deposit consists primarily of fully decayed materials, it is called muck. Squeezing a handful of fresh, wet soil can often tell them apart. Water that may be brown but not muddy squeezes out a handful of peat. Soil scientists term slightly decayed plant remains fibric, moderately decomposed ones hemic, and mostly decayed materials sapric. Organic soil or horizons carry the designation O, and the type of material is designated by the subscripts I, fibric, E, hemic, or A, sapric. Organic soils are very light, porous, and loose. These soils can soak up great amounts of water. Sphagnum peat can hold 10 to 20 times its own weight in water, but are low in nutrients. Organic soils are excellent for the production of certain vegetables, including onions, celery, lettuce, carrots, and other root crops. Peat, mostly sphagnum peat, is harvested for two purposes, energy and horticulture. Peat is, in a sense, a precursor of coal and can be harvested and burned as a fuel source. Horticultural peat, however, is widely harvested in North America, especially in Canada. Peat, particularly sphagnum peat, possesses properties desirable for inclusion in potting mixes and as soil amendments, mulches, and shipping materials for nursery stock. The acidity of sphagnum peat lends itself well as a soil amendment for acid-loving plants such as azaleas. To harvest peat, a bog is cleared and drained. The soil is then plowed and disced or otherwise stirred to promote drying of the surface layer. The dried peat can then be picked up and stockpiled and bagged for sale. Soil organic matter interests climate researchers because it is one of the Earth's largest reservoirs of carbon. When it decays, carbon dioxide, the main greenhouse gas, is released into the atmosphere. When more soil organic matter is created, carbon dioxide is removed from the atmosphere. Thus, the fate of soil carbon affects global climate. If the Earth warms, decay rates should speed up, releasing more carbon dioxide and increasing climate change even more. Histosols and gelosols present a particular concern. Both are gigantic carbon reservoirs held in place by cold or wetness. Two simple objectives would go a long way towards sequestering more carbon in farmland soil. Manage prime farmland for conservation of soil carbon and convert marginal farmland to permanent vegetative cover. In conclusion, proper fertilization, conservation, tillage, and crop rotation help preserve organic matter. Farming practices should be put in place to help this.